Welcome all the sports fans to another edition of Around the Rim. I am your host, the Dudster, Nesta Dudley, and this is week three, and we all know when it's week three. It's been week three consistently for 14 years. Week three, Steve Wright, head coach of the Bullets. Steve, welcome to Around the Rim.
Thank you, Nesta. Pleasure to be here.
And you know, Steve, I always wear my Bullet blue.
I love it. I love it.
Steve, your Bullets, 2-1. Your one lone loss. We'll talk about that in a second, but what kind of a world are we living in, Steve?
I don't know what's happened the last 2 years.
Bullets 2-1. I want to go down your roster, Steve. You got some returners, and you have a couple of really good new guys. Jamal Baskin-Robbins, Jonathan Diaz, Danny Knight, Michael Bonaponte, Jimmy Dean, Vladimir Samuel, Victor Tron, Islands, One Man Islands Joseph, Justin Gillis, Jeremy McCormick, and Frank Cipriano. Absent is the other Gillis brother, Josh Gillis.
Yeah, he got injured. He tore up his knee pretty bad. So, and it wasn't even the one that he hurt before.
Oh, no.
He tried to get a second opinion to come back, but they just said, well, this was his options. I would have played if it was me, but his options were walk later on in life or play basketball. Yeah. So he kind of wanted to walk, I guess.
Yeah. Sometimes it is make the wrong choice. No, I'm only joking about that.
You know, I agree, Nesta.
We certainly wish him well. We do go, Riff, go. But the Bullets, 2-1. You're sitting in the third seed, you know, the third slot. And Steve, that one lone loss, what happened? This is the second year in a row.
Well, what happened is, we gave up 62 points, and we only scored 60.
If all you sport fans that don't know, that one lone loss has been the Lakers. And I just have to do my journalistic duties and say that, you know, Steve, the Lakers, including the Big Dance, have beaten you the last four straight. That's not Bullet basketball.
No,
that upsets Bullets history.
Yeah, that's not good. That's kind of, I'm wondering what world we're living in, yeah, because that's just not right. It's a little off balance, I think. But, no, I mean, like us, I mean, we do come to play the Lakers, and I know the Lakers come to play us. And, you know, it has changed, but, you know, it has to change. It can't keep going on that pace. Mm-hmm. Do I expect more from my team? Yeah, because I don't think they should give up 62 points to anybody.
Yeah.
You know? And now, if we lost 42-40, I might be able to live with that because I know at least we kept them to 42.
Yeah.
But 62-60, I mean, that's just, it's like all offense. Yeah. On both sides, there was no defense.
I was just going to say that, you know, that you have always stressed on defense. Yeah. Your two championship banners, you had two solid defensive teams, even though in 88 you were completely satisfied before Around the Rim was created. But in 2004, because the last 10 years, Steve, you just haven't been satisfied with any version of your squad. But yet you're always usually in the thick of things.
Yeah, well, I guess luck. I don't know. Maybe it's the athletes we pick and not necessarily basketball players, but athletes. And they seem to give me everything they have, but I don't know. Maybe it's me getting older and I don't know, they're sick of listening to me or what. I don't know. But it's hard. It's hard. They have to learn teaching now. It's not just teaching the basics, trying to teach them to think on their own while they're out there, mm-hmm. you know, basketball sense. And it's not easy. And I know they got a lot of other things on their mind.
And that's where the LOT comes in, the lack of intelligence, because, you know, you can teach them, but you can't play for them.
Right.
And you will hope that they will retain the knowledge that you go over in practice. some coaches hope they retain the knowledge when they call a timeout and draw out a play, and they retain that knowledge. Sometimes that doesn't even happen.
Short term, I
saw like the Pistons, Paul Conrad, the coach of the Pistons, said at halftime he spent 10 minutes on going on the press. They come out, they didn't even go in it. So, you know, and that's what you're dealing with.
Yeah.
You know, so you just got to find ways around it and hope they listen to at least a few minutes of you and they finally get the – I know it takes 5 or 6 games for us to get going. That's usually when I can tell what kind of team I'm going to have. Mm-hmm. Usually takes about 5, 6 games to understand what I'm trying to teach them. So I'm hoping around 5 and 6, I should be able to tell what kind of team we have. Yeah. You know, a team that can go all the way or a team that's just going to make the playoffs and lose in the playoffs. So, you know, it's hard to tell. You just hope they keep learning and keep developing. I mean, that's all I can hope for.
Your three cornerstones on this team, in my opinion, your three-year seniors, you got Jimmy Dean, you have Michael Bonaparte, and you have Justin Gillis. Ever since you've drafted these folks, Steve, Coach Steve, that they have always gone to the big dance. In '04, they won. '05, they didn't win, but they went to the big dance. Yeah. So you certainly have madness experience there. And then, you know, Jamal Baskin, I think that was a very nice and huge pick for you. I mean, you know, that I really didn't see much of him at the tryouts. I didn't realize he was as good as he is, and he's a southpaw too. That's a really nice pick, I think.
Yeah, well, I knew he played other sports, and so I knew he was an athlete. And I know we didn't see him at the tryout, but I knew he was an athlete. Whether he was a first-round athlete, I had no clue. I took a guess when you're picking near the end, as Beanie could tell you.
Yeah,
you know, that it's tough. And, you know, I took a gamble. It paid off. You know, but there's other kids that I took a gamble that might not be. I'm just kidding. But you know what I mean?
Victor Tran, he is still solid.
Yeah, actually, I think he has gotten better. I think he's really learned how to play that center position, which we need because I didn't know what we were going to do for the center. Mm-hmm. And he's very good. He's a very smart kid, so he listens to everything, soaks in everything. And I think he's finally getting the because I know against the Lakers, he was one of the bright spots in the, you know, that loss. He certainly opened my eyes. So
yes. Now your center is usually Jimmy Dean, right? Or do you have him the power forward?
No, I usually use him forward a little bit in guard. I think he'd rather be guard the whole time if I let him. It just, we have too many guards.
Yeah.
And not a lot of height, so I need him for his height and his leaping ability. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I do switch him at center sometimes and forward, but mostly forward, mostly power forward. I like to keep Victor there, but when Victor's not there or Victor's taking a rest or I move him over there, but yeah, he could play anywhere. He don't mind.
And it appears to me the first three games anyway, Steve, that Bonaparte, Michael Bonaparte, has adjusted his game. He's going more on the inside and less on the outside. He still likes to jack those threes, but at least he's going into the paint. And I know you prefer that than the long ball.
Oh, definitely. And especially when we're 1 for 23 from the three-point line. Yeah. I think some people are taking shots that they should be relaxing. But yeah, I do, because I think he lost his shot. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I know he
does.
Plays,
he play football? Does he play?
He plays other sports. Yeah, he play. I know he does track. He does the shot put, and I know he does lacrosse. Mm-hmm. Might be lacrosse. So I know he plays other sports. So I don't know if he's lifting or whatever for that. But I know he's eating. Mm-hmm. I just don't. So. He don't mind driving. I mean, finally keyed him in after sophomore. Told him we needed him to drive, needed him to be underneath. And he certainly has done that, and he is a force inside. So that certainly will help us because we have a lot of guys who think they're three-point shooters.
Yeah, Well, you know, that's the whole league in general found. Again, another example of LOTism. Justin Gillis, it seems to me, Steve, that he's finally settled down comfortably into that point guard role. I mean, he seems more comfortable this year. It could be, you know, because he's a three-year senior, but he just seems like so comfortable this year. I mean, he's been running that point for 3 years.
Yeah, and as a sophomore, I think he learned from Phil Steele a little bit. Mm-hmm. Phil Steele took him under his wing a little bit, and I think that helped him. I think where he really didn't have to do anything as a sophomore, he kind of learned a little bit, and naturally the last 2 years. And I told him, I said, the offense is yours. I said, you know, you lead this offense. Mm-hmm. if we're not doing what we're supposed to do, I'm going to yell at you because you're the point guard. Yeah. You make it happen. So
they figure after 3 years, he should definitely know the system.
Definitely, yeah. So that's what I'm, you know, I mean, he does some things that irk me, and, mm-hmm. you know, I let him know it, and, you know, these guys certainly want to win, so, you know, they'll do what it takes. I just hope they develop to where I want them to be. I just hope we can reach the plateau that I want them to be.
Mm-hmm. You know? Steve, you hear that music? You're very you are very familiar with this. This is time for the MNBL Web. This is where I take the portion of this program to go and ask questions for up to 3 minutes, and these questions may or may not necessarily have to do with the MNBL basketball. Steve Wright, first question. We alluded to it at the beginning of this program. This Bullet squad, 20-06 season, are you satisfied with this squad, yes or no, at this point?
Not yet, no.
What does it take to be satisfied with any squad that you have? Because you have yet to be satisfied with a squad. Oh. Even in 2004, when you won the whole thing, you wasn't satisfied with that squad when I had you up here week three.
Well, if the Hawks hit their free throws, we would have lost the championship, so that's not satisfied. If we could keep a team to 40 points or under for a game, then I'll be happy. Because it's all defense with me. Has nothing to do with the offense. I leave that to the other guy. But defense to me, diving for a loose ball, you know, and playing right to the end and boxing out and not watching the other team rebound, then I'll be satisfied.
Besides 1988 and 2004, what was your best Bullet team?
Besides 88, 2004, probably 90. Was it 90? I was first place. I think it was 90. The years run into each other. But I think it was 90 with Raposa and Kitchen. Was that 90?
Raposa, Kitchen, that was 94.
94,
95.
94. Yeah, 94 was probably a real good squad. They definitely finished first. They only lost two games, and they played really well. And unfortunately, we lost in the first round. But I thought that was a really good team, mm-hmm. and I thought we should have went all the way with that team.
Mike Matarana, Ronnie Raposa, Rich Kinnerney. Which one will be on your all-time Bullet team leading the point?
Oh boy! Say that again. Raposa,
Ronnie Matarana. Raposa. Matarana, Rich Kinnerney.
That's tough.
That's why this is the web.
that's tough, but I'd probably have to say Matarana. He just gave me everything. I'm not saying the other guys didn't give me everything. Richie Kinnerney, I thought, could have gave me a little bit more. I thought he didn't give me his whole 100%. I like the kid even today. But I thought he could have gave me 100%. And Raposa, he didn't listen to me in the playoffs when Chucky put a man on him. I told him to just pass the ball. So he ticked me off there. But very good athlete, Ronnie. Very good athlete. But Matarana just, he had that bullish attitude that he just, you know, stubborn attitude. And he wanted to do everything he could to win. And he wasn't afraid to have the ball with 2 seconds to go. Mm-hmm. He wanted, matter of fact, he told the team he wanted the ball. Yeah. I can't say those words on TV, but, you know, and that's, to me, that's as close as to me as you can get is the way I played. You leave everything out on the floor, and that's just the type he was, you know.
Steve Wright, you are officially out of the web. The web certainly doesn't get any easier, Steve.
No, it certainly doesn't.
This weekend, you have a tough weekend. Now, what myself and Bradworth Benton, who's always representing, has said at the beginning of this year, that this year is a lot of parity in the MNBL. Virtually any team can beat any team on any given Saturday and Sunday. And we've actually already seen a couple of upset victories. But this weekend, you have the Pistons Saturday and the Hawks Sunday. Hawks right now are playing an unblemished ball, and the Pistons are playing 1-2, but such a much more improved Piston team than last year. I just want to read the Pistons roster real quick. Pistons had like 25 people on their team. Michael Fan, Marwin Mondesur, Alberto Diabla, Ryan D'Souza, Chris Michelli, Joe Wilhart, Kevin Barry, Lisandros Rodriguez, Alex Dominique, Michael Steele, David D'Souza, Alan Freeman, Phil Mutebi, those boys are in sync. I think Paul. Paul is definitely not going to come into the coming. It's definitely not going to be a soul dweller this year, but, you know, and he can wreck some team's groove, and this team could easily beat you. I don't want to say easily beat you, but this team has every chance in the world of beating you.
Yeah, right now I don't count on anybody to beat us. I really don't. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Paul always gets his squad ready, and I think he teaches really good, and he does a lot of things that we do, so it's kind of... you know, so I know what to expect. It doesn't mean we can always stop it because, mm-hmm. like I say, they have to think out on the floor. I can't, by the time I yell, it's too late. Yeah. They have to do it. But yeah, they have a very good squad. But not to correct you, but we're only playing the Pistons this week. We got the Hawks Kings the following weekend.
Oh, I thought
so
I.
So, yeah.
I looked at the schedule.
Yeah,
okay, well, since we were going to talk about the Hawks anyway, I'm going to bring it up. The Hawks right now playing unblemished balls. We have Rashawn Charles and Jonathan Moreau, Rubens Legentes, Kevin Liu, Jamie Guest, Dave Israel, Vicente Payo, Sam Pierre, William Liu, Rolf Prizome, John Generazio. Undefeated are the Hawks.
Yeah, very good squad. And they're, you know, since... Bernacos took over that team, and they've really done well. And since they come back, I should say, into mm-hmm. the league, they really done well, and they get their guys, they have their guys, they're ready to play every day. As soon as they put on that uniform, they're ready to play, and they've been tough. I mean, it seems like we face them in big games all the time. Mm-hmm. And, you know, yeah, we come out on the winning end, but, you know, that's due to change, too. I mean, they're just playing very, very well, and... you know, that's going to be a tough game.
Now, what do the Bullets have to do to maintain madness status in this league that is, you know, all this parity?
It's not easy. I mean, we have to play all together. I mean, we have to play as a team. We have to do the little things that the other teams aren't willing to do.
Mm-hmm. Which are examples?
Like diving for loose balls. Boxing out, moving without the ball on offense. It's tough to do. Mm-hmm. To move without the ball on offense is the toughest thing to do. It's easy to move when you have the ball. Mm-hmm. But it's very tough, and I know. But we have to do those little things, and our defense has to be the best. If we can't have our defense the best in the league, then we're in trouble. Mm-hmm. There's no, because we're not gonna be able to outshoot these other teams. You know, these other teams can score like 10 points in 2 seconds. We can't.
Yeah.
We have to work for our points.
Well, you know, traditionally, Steve, you have not had fast teams. Traditionally, you've had a few fast teams in the past. But traditionally, all 21 seasons, congratulations, by the way, the Bullets are not known for fast. They're known for their half-court offense and certainly defense.
Yeah, and this year I got a few guys who can run, and Jamal certainly gets quite a few steals. Being up top, and between him and Dean, if they just work off of each other, they should have a field day. They should have a field day of, you know, of fast breaks. But like I say, they have to work together, and they have to work together as a team. But yeah, I'd take away the three-point line if I could, because mm-hmm. we're that kind of offense. We're that half-court offense, which doesn't include we're banging them down low, drive to the hoop. You want 3 points, drive to the hoop, get it in, get the foul, hit it at the line. That's our 3 points
mm-hmm.
because the three-point line hasn't been our friend through the years. I mean, it just hasn't.
Yes.
You know, I mean, I do have to change things up a little bit, especially with the talent you're given. But I'd rather not, but if I have to, I will.
Well, there's that music, you know, a little taste, a little different music, Steve, a little old school flavor. It is time for the Rollers. Wasn't that good, Go Ref Go? It's time for the Rollers. So whenever you're ready, Go Ref Go, R.A. kick it with the Rollers. Past weekend play. All set. The week of January 14th. Old school and Planet Rock, and we have the Lakers and the Sixers, and the Lakers unveiling their 2005 championship banner. The champs unveiling their banner. Rashawn Vaughn, rather, starting off on the good foot, and Rashad Langston with the match. Langston outlets it to Ward. And here comes the Lake Show. Berger to Ward to Langston. Berger on the other end tells Ribeiro to get that stank outie. Vaughn splitting the lane. on Hound Dogs Langston for clean rejection, but Armstrong is there for the cleanup. Josh McCown, down low doing work. Emmanuel, beyond the arc, where everything is three. Ribeiro, setting reservations for three. Steve Wood, with the lean on me. Lakers victorious over the Sixers by a score of 65-53. LaFosse Highman for the Sixers, 12 points. Wood at all scores with 30 points. Brendan Berger allegedly had 8 blocks, but I've only seen one. Next game, Kings Hawks. Rubens Legentes attacking. Suda backdoors it to Rogers. Jamie Guest with the and one. Demir Safia with the deep double. Jamie Guest, he's gonna find Willie Lou. Lou with the little jumper. Danny Suda, he gonna take all three of these. And Suda memorexing. The next set, Jonathan Morose, Jayen. Bastine taking it to the rack. Legentes, he's at the line where everything is three. Is free, rather. Rogers in the Crayola. Safia, he's gonna stroke all three of these. Legentes, find Guest, all by he lonesome. Legentes with the lean on me while stroking all three of these. Hawks victorious over the Kings, and it took two extra frames, 71-60. High man for the Kings, Suda 23 points. Jamie Guest led all scores with 25 points. The Hawks improved to 2-0. The Kings dropped to 1-1. Third game, Pistons-Celtics. Pistons over the Celtics, 57-35. Lou led the Celtics with 14 points. Barry led all scores with 20 points. The Pistons improved to 1-1. The Celtics dropped to 1-2. First game Sunday, the Bullets over the Sonics that have always given them a hard time. Kelly led the Sonics with 16 points. Dean led all scores with 20 points. The Bullets improved to 2-1. Next game, Hawks-Pistons, 53-15. Final game, Lakers-Kings. Early season upset, Kings up by 154-53. Ward led all scorers with 21 points. That's how it all went down this past weekend. Now we are here for our weekly Around the Rim Awards so we can kill the music and kick it. Player of the week this past week, Jamie Guest. When you have Jamie Guest on your team and when the ball is in Jamie Guest's hands, you have damn good chances of making it to the Madness, even though I predicted him not to go to the Madness. Jamie Guest, Player of the Week. Coach of the Week. Coach of the Week goes to the Magic Man, Evans Rivera. Sometimes you have to make tough coaching decisions and tough love. They were losers this week, but Magic basically disciplined his guys to lose. Let's keep these splash screens up because we see my mug the whole 30 minutes. Team of the Week, the Hawks. The Hawks are the only team right now that are unblemished. Woo of the Week goes to Richie Rodgers. Richie Rodgers of the Kings in the first half had the Kings on their back, scoring all his points, down low in the middle. Now you can put the screen on
me.
Down low in the middle, carrying the Kings on their back that first half. The Kings 1 point better than the Lakers. Richie Rodgers, this woo is for you. Woo! Now on to the official MNBL standings. Remember, I don't care who you talk to, what you read. If it don't match this, it just taint official. The Hawks on top of the league, 3-0, followed by the Lakers. Bullets and Kings, both 2-1. They haven't played each other, but the Bullets get the third slot because B comes before K on this planet Earth. Celtics, Pistons, Sonics, Sixers. That's how it goes right now. Go, ref, go.
Can I introduce it?
You can introduce
All
it.
All right.
You waited 3 weeks to do this,
I
brother.
I did. The next screen is the MNBL Dirty Dozen.
Dirty Dozen. These are the guys that are most likely to hack the stuff out of you. Right now, Brendan Berger, Mr. 8 blocks in one game, and I already seen one, is leading the league. He's the dirtiest dozen of the ball with 13, followed by Serto. Bastien, both have 12. Lafosse, Philippe, 11. McCown, 11. Israel, Langston, 10. Bonaparte, 10. Ray Charles, 10. Richie Rogers, 10. Dean, Jimmy Dean, 9 fouls. That is the dirty dozen. Always always your most favorite category. Go, Ref, go.
Absolutely, because it ain't no fun roughing a game if you can't call a foul.
I hear you. On to next week's games. Saturday, first game, Pistons-Kings, followed by the Hawks, Sixers, Lakers, Sonics, and that Pistons-Kings, this one, folks, is just too close to call. Second game Sunday, the first game, Bullets-Pistons, Sixers-Sonics, Celtics-Kings, and in that second game, it's going to be battle for butt-naked last. I just entertained myself, Waldo. Yeah. Let's go to those wrap-it-up screens. Around the rim, I don't have this memorized yet, so let's go up to this last screen. Around the rim, play. There you go. Live every Thursday night, 7:30, Channel 3, 7:30 in the p.m. It replays every Friday night, 10 o'clock in the p.m. on Channels 3 and 15, and replays every Sunday morning, 7 in the a.m. That's
you
right.
Know, it's
I
only
said
been,
7.
What, how many years?
That's right, 7 in the a.m. Excuse me?
I said it's only been how many years?
But I added these three splash screens this season.
That's true.
Yes. Next screen. When to watch them? Each Monday through Wednesday at 3 o'clock on channels 3 and 15. And the GOTW, Game of the Week, is every Friday night at 10:30 on channel 3. And this week's Game of the Week, it just happens to be the Bullets versus the Lakers, the first Sunday of this season, January 8th. Next screen, please. Where to read them? The Marlin Evening News every Friday night. And if you guys are a bunch of skates and you're too cheap to spend the 75 cents, you can go to the MMBL official website, which is mmbl19.tripod.com. Steve, with the remaining couple of minutes after 14 years of doing this show, I'm getting close to doing it right. I got splash screens and everything.
Yeah, that's professional. Jeez, I remember when you first started, I was here the first show. Nothing went right.
Yeah.
Not even the sound. I don't think there was a lot of sound.
Steve, not much has changed. It's just the splash screen.
Well, Steve, we certainly wish you good luck in your endeavors for this 2006 season. I did predict that the Bullets would go to the big dance. I predicted Bullets, Celtics in the big dance, and Celtics over the Bullets. I'm sorry. But Bradworth Benton, who's always representing, predicted Bullets, Celtics, and Bullets to take the whole damn thing.
Yeah, let's hope that comes true. We got a lot of work to do, and it would be nice to get back there. But it has been a good few years. Let's hope we can just keep it going. And let's hope we can come out with a W this year. Yeah.
Steve, do you have any shout-outs? Do you have any news that you want to share with us? I didn't want to say anything, but you might want to say something.
Yeah, I'm going to have my first child in the end of July, so I'm really excited. My wife's having it, not me.
Your wife's having it. You'll be paying for it.
That's right.
Well, Steve Wright, thanks for joining us.
Lester, thank you very much.
It's always a pleasure. Hopefully, you'll be up here on the one hour All Madness special. Until then, I want to say buenas noches, muchas cuchas. I came in peace. I leave with love. This is for the red, the black, and the green. And I'll be seeing you at the game.
To the hoop. My favorite play is the alley-oop. I like the pick and roll. I like the give and go.